Okay, it's nothing like taking things back apart, and I just got through taking the valve chest apart. And now the part that'll be built is this part right here, which is the valve gear and the slide valve itself and how all that works together. So what I'll be looking at is this part right in here. Now, up in here, this is a little bit smaller diameter right in here that I'm drawing, and that is 3/32 of an inch. Down here, I'm going to be threading this. That's a 5BA thread. So what I'll do is I'll find an equivalent imperial thread here in just a minute, and then I'll go ahead and thread both of those. In fact, whatever this thread is, this thread down here. Also, there's a clevis down here that we'll need to go to, and the clevis will be the part that goes down and goes into the eccentric rod that's on this engine right here. So here's how I'm going to do this. Essentially, this is the part that this section will be about, is this little rod. Put the tube in it. Thousandths, somewhere between 93 and 94 thousandths. Well, moved it on the way out. That's 95 thousandths. I'm not going to fret over 1 thousandth on something that's not critical. So I'm off 1 thousandths, a little bit too big, but it'll fit just fine. Let's go back and try it out on the piece. A few videos back, and I think it was in this series, I think it was, it may have been in the little PM3 series, I'm not quite sure what it was, but I talked about the importance of getting some pretty handy books. And I know Machinery's Handbook is one that everybody really likes, and I have a couple of copies of Machinery Handbooks. The Machinery Handbook, as excellent as it is also sometimes overkill. It tells you everything that you'd want to know about almost any type of engineering specs or machining specs that one would come across. And by the way, I do recommend for the home shop, if you're not doing CNC work, is don't get the new Machinery's Handbook. Not that they're bad, but they focus a lot on the CNC and not so much on the machine, on the manual work that I do and perhaps you do in your shop. And you can go back, you know, decades and find that, because threads haven't changed and sizes haven't changed and so forth. The only thing is, in some of the earliest tools out there are machinery handbooks or machining textbooks. If you go too far back, they don't list carbide tools, but that's just a very small percentage of the home shop anyway. Why do you need these books? Well, when you come across the project that I'm just talking about right now, and here's the piece that I just finished, and I don't know if you can make out, but it's got that little minor dimension on it right there. But now I've got to thread it, and that's this part right in here has to be threaded, and this part back here has to be threaded. Of course, I said it's 5BA. I don't have a 5BA. But what I do have here, though, is a piece of stock that's nominally 125 thousandths. Now, in my handbook, I can come over here, and let me see, get me this little straw pointer. You always find these things, by the way, on these spray cans when you're not needing them. I don't know what that's off of, but it's a little small one, probably something lost. Anyway, back what I was talking about. So I come down through here, and my major diameter of this, I'm in basic thread dimensions and tap drill sizes, American National Coarse Thread. It's just because that's what I turn to first, and I know I happen to have the tap that I'm going to need for this. So I come down, and it's 1.25, which is the same diameter as that thing I had a while ago, wherever it went to, is this. So that means a thread that will match that is a 540. So all I need to do is take the 540 tap over there and then tap down 11 millimeters or about 7/16 of an inch. And that'll be what those threads there will be. So 7/16 of an inch is 437 thousandths, actually 437 and a half. So I'll just put that at 437. And then I'll go back about the same distance for my thread. Now for this, I'm going to take it to the lathe and put it in the die holder for the tailstock so that my threads will be straight. And then I'm just going to turn it over and I'll tap this end. I'm not going to show this. I've had enough threading operations in the lathe that by now I'm confident that you have seen me do that. I'll be right back after I get this threaded. Okay, this is back, and I don't know if you can see that or not, but there's the smooth end up there. There's my 540 thread and more 540 thread. So that's the way that part right there is going to be when it gets in. And this part right here, I'll be making the little sleeve that goes across for it. Now the reason those threads are on there, if by now I'm sure you figured it out, but that's how you adjust the timing, is by moving this little bar here that I'm about to make back and forth. I'm going to make it real quick and I'll show you what I'm talking about. This is the part. It's just a very, very small solid brass part, about 1/8 of an inch, probably looks like about 3/16, and it'll actually fit down in there. And it needs to be a pretty tight fit. The reason is you don't want any play back and forth, because if it is, you'll have some lag built in. So you want that to be a relatively tight fit when it goes in. Now, it's not a press fit. It's probably just slightly this side of a sliding fit in there. It goes in with absolutely no problem at all. But when it goes in, it does not move back and forth. So the next step is just to go ahead and center a hole and tap it for 540. Okay, I'm back from the drill press, and now it's time to put everything together. And what I'll do is, this piece right here goes in here, the little valve gear rod, and this has to go down over there like that. And of course now the threads will catch it. There it goes. It must have a small burr on it. Let me just do this. Grab it, get past that burr. Might need to run the die back through it one more time, because that needs to be adjusted. There it goes. Now it can be adjusted by hand. All right, now this piece right here goes in here, like so. Lot got to go on in there. All right, now I got that. Now that's how my valve works. So I've got to get it to where it needs to be. I need to make the middle of it out just a little bit. I don't know if you can kind of see that. There's a lot going on. I'm going to try to zoom in just a little bit. I don't know if you can see that or not, but I'm going to zoom in and see what you got here. Try to zoom on in. There it goes. Now I got it in the picture. Now, okay, there's one valve open, which it should be, but it needs to be down just a little bit more to one edge. And that valve there is open, so these two right here are closed. That may be enough to make it run, actually. I believe it is. I'm going to leave it like that. I don't believe that's overlapping any. It doesn't take much. In fact, I think that works pretty good. But now you see how that worked. And I know people left lots of comments, and to tell you the truth, I should have looked at it before it came out through here. But when this valve is over here, this inlet is putting in steam, and it's going outside this hole right here. Right now, steam will go in here because it's coming in. There'll be an inlet on this part right here to push steam, and it'll go down here and up through there. I'm just going to draw a picture of it, because check back a couple of videos, and a couple of people caught the way that I had explained it backwards. It had been 20 years since I'd really given it much thought. But that's how the slide valve actually works inside that engine. In other words, now when it's this way, the piston is actually going this way. When I go that way, the piston is going that way. So this runs in opposite of what the piston is moving. This pushes the piston that way, and this right here, when it went that way, it pushed the piston this way. All right, so that's how the slide valve works. And I probably confused myself, and probably about all the viewers of this video. But anyway, I'll draw a picture. And by the way, there's some great illustrations out there on how this D valve actually works. I'm going to give that a shot. If it doesn't work, I'll come back and I'll trim a little bit more off the inside. You know what? I might just go ahead and put my file in there and do that right now. I think that's what I'm going to do, is just take a triangle file and go ahead and file some off the bottom of this valve chest. Why not do it right when you got it instead of worry about has it been done? I'm going to be right back after I do a little file work. Okay, I don't even know if you can see that mark because it's so small. In fact, I think it's less than 10 thousandths. That's at 90. That's about 10 thousandths. I'm just going to file 10 thousandths off of each inside of that corner. I've marked it and I put a line on it to file to. Okay, that did not take long. By the way, don't be afraid of file work. If you get yourself a good file, and this is a good coarse file right here, and if you go ahead and mark it out and then file going through this way some, then turn it around in your vise and then go through that way some, make sure you're even on both sides. It took me less. I guarantee you, I could not even have got this in the vise over there in the milling machine in the time that I spent filing this thing down. Okay, after that, I've got good throw on either side of it. I feel very, very comfortable that little modification right there is going to be just fine. So that, gentlemen, once it gets all the screws back in it, now I'm going to take a little bit. This ended up, when I was working it, there's about a, I need to go back and probably cut a, maybe 4 or 5 thousandths off the bottom of this thing. I'll just screw it up in the four jaw and do that. And, but I'm going to put this all together and put this back on it and put it back in the toolbox and, or back in the parts and say, you know what? It's a done deal. Make sure I got everything right. I'll see you on the next video.